Throughout the century, transportation has evolved from classic horseback riding to cable cars, all the way up to the modern day automobile. Today, we're going to take you on a journey of the history of the cable car.
The inventor of the first cable car was Andrew Smith Halliday. He was born in London on March 16, 1836. Stories claim that he thought of the idea while watching horses haul cars up Jackson Street.
Andrew Halliday was inspired from a young age from his father, who worked in a wire rope company, which is the equivalent of modern-day steel cable. And when later in his life, when he incorporated this steel cable into miners who were lifted through the shafts with these cables, he was able to use this as the method of pulling the cable cars up and down the hills of San Francisco.
Halliday built the first model cable railway and obtained financing from three partners, Collis P. Huntington, Leland Stanford, and Charles Crocker and Mark Hopkins. He received the first cable car-related patent on January 17, 1871. The old rich people who funded it didn't want to walk up to the hill to have to stay on Nabob Hill, so the cable car could carry them in style.
On August 2, 1873, Halliday did the first successful cable car test run. Halliday took the grip himself because the other grip men were too skeptical of the performance.
The cable car line started up on the 1st of September, 1873, and from then on to his death, Halliday was filthy rich and contributed a lot of his money to the San Francisco community and its people.
Now let's talk about the components of the cable car. Despite the technological advancement at the time, there are only 13 moving parts.
Because the cable car not only travels uphill but downhill, it is made up of 7 brakes. The wheel brake, the emergency brake lever, the track brake lever, the wheel brake pedal, the wheel brake, the track brake, and the rear wheel brake lever. The most important of these brakes is the wheel brake pedal, and that is used mostly.
The cable car's grip, essentially a 300-pound plus pair of pliers, extends through a slot between the rails and grabs hold of the cable to pull the car along. The harder the grip man pulls the handle back, the more pressure the grip exerts on the cable until the cable car is moving at the same speed of the cable, approximately 9.5 miles an hour.
To stop a cable car, the grip person must let go of the cable. Each car has 3 types of brakes: the wheel brake, the track brake, and the emergency slot brake. Each wheel has its own wheel brake, a soft steel shoe that presses against the wheel to help stop the car. Track brakes are 2-foot-long blocks of Monterey pine, located between each of the 4 sets of wheels. When the grip person pulls back on the track brake lever, the blocks press against the track brake to help stop the car. When the grip person pulls back on the red emergency brake lever, very rarely done, the slot brake, a 18-inch steel wedge, is forced into the slot between the rails, abruptly stopping the car.
These are merchant marine ships. And in 1940, England sent a group of people over here to our government, and they wanted us to build merchant ships for them. They were in the war, and then the war had already started in Europe, and they were losing all their merchant ships left and right to German submarines. But we couldn't build them for them in naval facilities, so we were busy building our own ships, knowing that the war was going to start eventually in the United States. So they told the group from England, our government said, you're going to have to go to the private sector. So they went and they saw Henry Kaiser Aluminum and Todd Ship Building. And they asked them if they could possibly build ships for them, merchant ships. And they said, yeah, we can do that. And in 1941, we got into the war. And we needed merchant ships too. We didn't have a lot of merchant ships. So they began to form 18 different shipyards around the country to build these ships. And from 1941 to 1945, the United States built 2,710 of these ships, merchant ships. And this particular ship was built in 1943 in Portland, Maine. And we're lucky to have this. There's only two left out of 2,710 ships. It was like an assembly line type thing. The record for a ship was over in Richmond Shipyard. It was built in 4 days and 17 hours or something like that. And that was Kaiser's son was the head of that shipyard. And everything was perfect. They worked around the clock. In fact, all the shipyards worked 24 hours, 7 days a week. A lot of the people working there were women and minorities. It's just amazing what they were able to do. And they were unskilled in the beginning. They all had to be trained how to weld. They didn't know anything about building ships. And this is some of the convoys. We'll get into the convoys in the next thing. But where these ships went, they went to Great Britain. They went to the Mediterranean all the way into here for the North African campaign. The most dangerous route for liberty ships was going to Murmansk, Russia, all the way over here. Besides the weather, there were just a lot of submarines and German, other kinds of ships that would blow them out of the water. And then, of course, the Hawaii and New Zealand, they just went all over the world through the Panama Canal.
During World War II, liberty ships were built 365 days a year, 24 hours a day, all of the time. Each ship was 52 miles of welding, if you lined it up. 28,000 rivets, 3,200 tons of steel, 7.5 miles of pipe, 4.75 miles of electrical wire, and 25 tons of paint. Liberty ships came at a cost. We had 50,000 losses of life and hundreds of thousands of casualties building these ships. Building over 2,000 ships, liberty ships, made from 1941 to 1945.
We should go over there.
The first step for the invasion of Normandy on D-Day in 1944 was the unloading of our ships. This is an exact replica of the Jeremiah O'Brien unloading all of the equipment to be shipped out on the landing craft, mechanized craft, and wooden landing craft, which you see here, which take all of the supplies, jeeps, ships, guns, and bring them over to the coast. Next, we have the breakwaters, which were 59 sunken ships that they created to shelter along the open coast so the supply ships could unload without any wake or turbulence. Next, the unloading onto a floating pier, a landing craft tank unloads safely, and it would, in a tenth of the time it would to have taken to cross the beach on these piers, because they're nice and solid. The floating piers, as you see here, piers floated up and down with the tides and the waves so they wouldn't break, and created artificial harbors. Next, the barrage of balloons. Balloon cables menaced low-flying German aircraft. These balloons are shown flying much lower than their usual several hundred foot altitude, so they can protect us. Special sand. This is actually sand from Normandy, the actual beach they were able to put in this, replicate this model.
Omaha Beach. This is some of the cargo that was actually on the ship, but this, like, some cargo that would be on the ships, some, like, the jeeps and stuff. And then we have here a chaplain's music organ here. That was actually on it.
What the loading or unloading would look of the Jeremiah. This was painted by a World War II vet. And all of the, if you turn around, Brad will show you all those wooden planks you see could have been lifted up. And all of the cargo in the painting could have been transported to this area for storage to bring to the battlefield. Fun fact, the Jeremiah O'Brien was actually never hit, and it's
11 tours back and forth to the battlefront. Its only other time I was hit was one of its life vessels was hit by strap gun, but that's it. It was never actually hit, so it was called the Lucky O'Brien.
All right, should I start talking?
Yeah.
This model is a close replica of the actual O'Brien's main engine and will actually run on steam. Steam enters through the pipe on the right and is directed by valving to the top or bottom of the high-pressure, small-diameter piston. Then the steam expands, losing pressure and energy as it pushes the piston and rotates the propeller shaft. Even at reduced pressure, it has plenty of energy left. It is then directed through a second valve to the medium-pressure piston similarly. The steam is then sent to the low-pressure piston. So this is essentially just a replica of on a smaller scale of what the O'Brien engine would look like and how it would operate. Here is a placard of the Jeremiah O'Brien. Here is every named Liberty ship ever built from 1941 to 45. It's astonishing.
In the aft section on the O'Brien, during the war it had another 3-inch gun, but after reasons, right? There's only 3/4 of an inch of steel down there between you and that ocean. And the concussion of a torpedo would just split the sides of the ship open. And if you were down below the water level, you'd be instantly flooded. Okay, it was just death down there. Second, the steam that's generated, David will take you through this down there, in this line, is at 250 PSI, 450 degrees Fahrenheit. If one of these lines gets cracked, that steam would come out and cut a man in half. So it's very, very dangerous, but the steam's on that high pressure, sure. Temperature. Everything you see here was done outside at factories outside, and things were put together like an erector set. For example, this whole engine was lifted and dropped in. Okay, by hoist. This engine was manufactured outside and actually assembled here by hoist as one piece. All the pipe.
We're lucky to have this. There's only two left out of 2,710 ships. This one, and there's one back in Baltimore called the John Brown. That is not, this is unaltered. This is just the way it was in the war, basically. Except this was just a cargo hold.